join me?
Sure.
As you know, we started with the chief, with General McConville, 40,000 feet. It's now time to dive down into the 20,000 foot level.
Sure.
Particularly the equipping pegs. One of the things that I feel that the Army is most misunderstood, everybody understands the F-35, everybody understands aircraft carriers, right?
Yeah.
Everybody understands GBSD. Right. Even though it's because they're the big programs.
Right.
The place where I have felt historically that the Army has fought from a deficit of, it's not been support, it's been lack of understanding, particularly what's in the equipping pegs.
Okay.
And so that's, let me welcome you to the floor.
Sure.
You have the con.
All right, Jim.
Yes, sir.
Well, I noticed there was a lot more applause for my predecessor there. I don't know. Following the chief is always
one
a
team,
balance.
Sir. One yeah. team.
But thanks, Jim.
Yes, sir.
For hosting this event and this conference. This makes a difference, I think, here in D.C. for what you do for us and all our industry partners, especially.
Thank you,
thanks
sir.
Thanks to Sam Adcock, who I just was chatting with here, for being your co-host. And I hope next year we're able to get back to normal and do it in a location with everybody in the audience. But thanks for pulling this through in our COVID environment here.
Yes, sir.
To make it happen. So a month or so ago, got my my guy who helps me do my remarks over here off site, but they came in, they said, hey, where do you want to be in the two-day lineup? And I said, I don't know, busy. You guys figure it out. I don't really care, just working with Jim's guys and tell me where I go. What I should have done is said, I don't want to anywhere but follow the chief. And so obviously what happened, because Murphy kicked in and I'm following the chief of staff of the Army.
Yes, sir.
And it reminds me of when I was, my wife and I, Liz, we went to a Bruce Springsteen concert back in like 88 in Austin, Texas. And if you remember our concerts, there's a warm-up band ahead of time. Nobody listens to them, but you're sitting there because the boss is next. You're gonna wait for Bruce Springsteen. Well, that's what's kind of happening here today. Except the warm-up band is after the boss. And so probably everybody's trickling out to the parking lot to get in their car.
A little bit of broken beer cancer.
Yeah, rather than listen to the staff chump here. But and I know Mr. Bush, Doug Bush, and General Murray have also spoken about the Army previously. So really, what is there more to talk about? But I'd say the G8, maybe it's worth listening here from my point of view on where we are on resources. And I was here listening to General McConville's meeting with you a bit ago. And more specifically, I'll talk in some detail for our industry partners' sake of where we are in the equipping portfolio and resources. So, you know, as we all know, the PB-22 is not rolled out yet. It's delayed. Everybody knows that. We're hopefully a week or so out from that. So I can't get into the details. I'll talk it in generalities of where we're heading or where we landed. It's not quite done yet. I'm not sure where it is in the process, but I will share what I can without crossing that line that I can't. To reiterate what the chief said here on where our investments were in the budget that will be rolled out, it's very consistent with the guidance and the priorities that we've been operating under in the last 3 or 4 years. And we have the three priorities of people, readiness, and modernization that we're all very familiar with. And on the people front, so when we roll out our budget, I think you'll see that we're holding steady on end strength. We're gonna resource it that for the reasons General McConville just talked about. Although there has been an Afghanistan decision, the pace of the Army and the demand of the Army is not changing. In fact, in some aspects, it's different. And when we see where we end up in Afghanistan, eventually, you know, we'll make maybe some minor adjustments, but that is not a big change to the demand of the Army. And so we are still holding, we're resourcing for where we are today at 485. And then also we're resourcing all those critical soldier and family programs to where they need to be to support our most valuable resource. On the readiness fronts, we have made great strides in readiness. I attribute that to General Milley. He came in and readiness was number one. He flipped it 180. We got our heads literally out of the sand in Iraq and Afghanistan. We resourced high-end combat warfighting capabilities. And where we are today is so much better. We're in a different world from a readiness perspective, especially at the BCT level. And so the chief will not walk away from that. And so we are gonna continue to resource the readiness accounts to ensure that we maintain that edge that we have today in readiness to support our combatant commanders and also a hedge against the unknown out there. And then finally, on the modernization front, we'll continue to prioritize those 31+4 signature programs that we're very familiar with, overseen by the 8 CFTs and RICTO by General Thurgood out there. There has been real progress in that area over the last 3 or 4 years, but that progress is fragile, and I want to talk about that in the base of my remarks here. So we continue to fund those priority programs at the cost of the other programs in the equipping portfolio. So a quick recap on how we resourced our modernization priorities over the last few years I think is important. I won't go into all that background that I have done in past events like this, but having that understanding is important to tell the story of why we're fragile today. And so back in 2018, we recognized that our top line was going to be flat at best. It really didn't cover inflation in some aspects, but it was flat. And we also knew that where the top line was disposed, it was misaligned. It wasn't where it needed to be based on those priorities that emerged. So we had dollars in the wrong places. And within a year about that same time, we had the 6 modernization priorities were established. The cross-functional teams were stood up, headed by general officers, and also Futures Command all came. So there's this big swirl that all came together at the same time. And in May and June of 18, just about 3 years ago right now, we did that first deep dive that General McConville talked about a bit ago, where we went through and looked for a lot of dollars out of our what we're calling legacy and enduring programs to fund those next generation capabilities overseen by the CFTs and then subsequently RCDO. So I said legacy and enduring. So we've been doing some thinking about how to define those non-CFT programs. So legacy is a term that we're using to describe older systems which are not intended for upgrade or future use against those near peer adversaries we're concerned about. And so a good example of that is the M113. We still have that system, that vehicle, in our ABCTs today. They were in the brigade when I was in there as a lieutenant. So we're not doing anything but to sustain the 113. And there are other like systems like that throughout the Army. An enduring system or program is used to describe older systems, but they're intended to be incrementally upgraded over time because they're going to be fighting along these next generation capabilities that we're developing under AFC into the future. And we must have them in their formation and they must be credible against the threat we foresee. And so a good example of that is the Stryker. We've had it for 20 years. We're going to have it at least another 20, 25 years. There's no plan to replace the Strykers. And so we're putting billions of dollars into Stryker to incrementally upgrade them with both lethality and survivability upgrades. So in the equipping of portfolio alone, in the last 3 cycles, we've eliminated 141 programs, and we've reduced an additional 177. Now, I should be good at math as a G8. I'm not. It's something probably over 300 there. But we've moved, and a vast majority of those dollars, over $30 billion, landed in the cross-functional teams inside of what the priorities are. And over the last 3 years, the number of programs that are eliminated and reduced and the associated dollars has been less and less each year. So, and why is that? Well, as the Chief said, that first deep dive, we took a lot of risk. We knew we had to jumpstart the CFTs. So we took a big swing at things, and we moved a lot of dollars. About $17 billion of those dollars was that first year that moved into the CFTs from enduring and legacy. Second, there was a lot of programs that were simply optimized for coin. We took a lot of risk, but we focused surely on there. We had like counter IED equipment that was rolled into our base program, and we were walking away from that at that point in time. And subsequently, we became more refined in the program-by-program reviews. It was kind of a pretty hastily done the first time, I would say. We refined it and had better information on the table as we made decisions. And as we continued to cut, we started to see where those red lines were on those non-CFT programs that we couldn't cross. And so it made us to be more thoughtful on the decision and the cuts that we made. But each year it got harder and harder to find more dollars as we got close to that line in those non-CFT programs. And our CFTs, finally, I would say they became very well resourced. And when you had fact of life changes within the CFTs, we were able to fund requirements, or UFERs, we call them inside the Army, within the CFT pot of money. So we didn't have to take down the legacy or enduring to support CFT requirements. We could adjust internal to that pot of money there. And so The next thing I'd like to walk you through is we have a new priority. So you have the CFTs, the 31 plus 4, and then right under that, the second priority is what we're calling key enablers, and that'll be rolled out here in 22. And these are about 30 or so programs that are directly tied to the success of the cross-functional team and RCDO efforts, that 31 plus 4. And that if you don't deliver a key enabler, you will not optimize the CFT capability once it's delivered. And so we have about $24 billion invested in those key enablers, those 30 or so programs. And the greatest example, the best example I use a lot when I describe it around the building, is the Q53 radar. So today, in 90 degree sense mode, it can get out to about 60 kilometers. We're building an IRCA that can shoot 70 kilometers. And so we have to have a radar that can sense out past that so that you take full advantage of this artillery piece that we're delivering to give us overmatch against our adversaries. So we're putting the money into Q53 radar to extend the range to it out well past 70, so that when, and it's resourced to deliver in time to coincide with IRCA in 23. So that's an example. And we've done that across those 30 or so programs, so they deliver in time to support the CFT effort once it comes online. So to kind of put this into context a little bit on where the dollars stand inside of the equipping portfolio, in just 22, when it rolls out, 47% of the equipping portfolio funding, and we have $35 billion or so inside of the equipping portfolio, 47% of that is either in the 31 plus 4 or those key enablers that are directly tied to them. The other 53% in 22 is everything else, about 500 programs versus about 65 programs. So, but if you look in the FYDP of 22 to 26, it's 50%, so it goes up 3%. We continue to prioritize the efforts of the six modernization priorities. So 50 cents of every dollar we have in the equipping portfolios are against about 65 programs. The other 50% are against the other 500 that are not, less prioritized. And that shows a commitment of our leadership in the prioritization of what it can do for you if they stay priorities over time. So where does that leave the equipping portfolio? Well, I'd say first, we are on schedule to deliver the 31 plus 4 next generation capabilities on a schedule that's aggressive but necessary, given what our adversaries are doing and trying to keep pace with us. We have to have these on the schedule. They're right now the resource to deliver, or I think we start and accept some risks we won't be comfortable with. The key enablers, they are also a resource to deliver on schedule to be on time with those CFT programs they support. And then as I mentioned, about the 50% of the dollars in there spread around against those other 89% of programs, those 500 programs that aren't the priority, they've been reduced to a point where further reductions are very concerning. And so this is due to the fact that we didn't get a top line increase. As I mentioned, it was flat. This was all resourced internally by doing this prioritization drill. So what that has put the non-CFT, those legacy enduring, in a very precarious position. They're right on, and some they're on the edge of viability. So that's why it's concerning. And that's why I think we're in a fragile position right now. Those legacy and enduring programs remain essential capabilities. We can't operate as an army without them. And they are sometimes called the unloved inside the equipping portfolio. We've taken schwacks at them 3 years in a row in some instances. And they are not sexy. They're not a hypersonic missile that flies thousands of kilometers and can strike a 10-digit grid. But without those capabilities I'm talking about, we fail. You have to have them. And so right now they're resourced, in some of them, a good bit of them, on the margin of viability. And to reduce them further would push many of them across that line where we have a big problem. So a significant reduction in the Army top line as it would roll into the equipping portfolio. We were faced with those, quote, tough problems, the really difficult decisions. Do we eliminate or reduce more of those gotta-have capabilities that are somewhat unloved in the past, that are not right on the margin, and creates a problem on that aspect of the Army? Or do you delay the scheduled delivery of the CFT and RCDOs, the 31 plus 4 programs, that we think we need to have on the schedule that they're supposed to deliver today. That is what's before us if we have a significant top line reduction. So looking a little bit into, you know, China, Russia, and what the NDS is telling us to do. You know, SecDef, that's clearly been his first day. I think it's confirmation here. You talked about China as a pacing threat. It's been codified in documents inside the building. And so how's that been translated inside the Army? Well, first, we believe a lot of our investments that we're making today in the CFTs have a direct application into that tough problem in the Indo-Pacific. I listened to the chief. I'll reinforce a couple things, but we'll try and plow the same ground. The number one priority, as you know, is long-range precision fires. And PrSM, you know, which had the test yesterday, we're very excited about that it flew as far as it did and hit what we were shooting at. We have what we're calling a mid-range capability. We're leveraging Navy programs of record to fill a gap in between PrSM and what the long-range hypersonic missile will go, the range, and they're all delivering in 23. It's going to really change what the Army's capabilities are in support of the joint force. And then in the air and missile defense, another huge priority or difference maker in the Indo-Pacific, we're delivering all those programs as we've talked the last couple years. That includes IFPC. We have Iron Dome in our hands today, two batteries, and we'll make an enduring IFPC decision here in fourth quarter of 21, just around the corner. RICTO is developing non-kinetic solutions in air and missile defense, things like high-powered microwave and directed energy capability, and it's promising what they're testing right now under RICTO. LTAM's a new Patriot radar to get rid of the one that we have now that's incredibly costly to operate. They're just old and not very good. And LTAMs will allow us to employ the MSE Patriot missile out to its fullest range. And then I think most importantly is IBCS. Once we get IBCS across the line, we had a good LUT within the last year that everybody was interested in, but that will allow us to attain our JADC2 objectives within the Army and also allow us to deploy our Patriots at battery level instead of battalion. Our Patriot is our most stressed force in the Army. That's because we have to deploy them as battalions now. Now that we can meet battery objectives and we can give a little break to our Patriot force over time. So I use a conceptual idea from my Japanese friends. I commanded the Army in Japan for a few years before I had this job. And they had this fences and windows concept when they were talking about, and they were talking about MDO and how they would see it applied in Japan. And so I think what they talked about is from a deterrence or defensive perspective, long-range fires and AMD, they can, when you put them on a key piece of ground somewhere, you can put up a fence against an adversary you're trying to deter. And essentially, you're establishing your own A2AD environment for that adversary to deal with from a defensive perspective. And then from the windows perspective, by employing long-range fires from key terrain, we can go ahead and establish a windows of opportunity for our joint force partners. We have the best Air Force and Army, or Air Force and Navy in the world. We are part of that joint force, and long-range fires provides those opportunities for the joint force to get where they need to be. So, and I could go down the rest of them, but I'm going to just kind of slam through toward the end, because I think you're familiar with everything the CFTs are doing. If we have time for some questions, I can answer some specific details there. A couple of things on non-CNT CFT investments, and then we'll wrap this up. So there's an ISR task force. General Laura Potter is our G2 since we did this last year, and she's filling gaps that we have in our ISR portfolio in both space, aerial, and terrestrial layers right now. We are in the process of making divisions and corps great again. We stood them down as warfighting headquarters. They essentially passed reports back in the coin days, but now they're to win in the future, we have to have a warfighting corps, warfighting divisions, and we're creating C4I and fires, EW, intel, cyber, other capabilities that our divisions and corps need to fight and win. Our BCTs will remain that force that closes with and destroys the enemy. They close, continues to be the closing force. We have billions of dollars aligned with our to make our BCTs continue on the edge of where they need to be. Those incremental upgrades in most instances, OMFV over time will replace the Bradley But we are very much committed to the ABCTs and the Striker, especially with those upgrades I've talked about before. Then just in the sustainment, even also looking at our watercraft, which is so critical to the Indo-Pacific, but they are not ready for that environment today. So we're looking at the next generation watercraft, and we're also looking at our maybe a common tactical truck. Today we have our it's a well-worn out fleet of vehicles that were fielded when I was a lieutenant, and we're trying to just keep them running, and we're looking at an option, how do we do that in the future? And doing that will pay for itself if we make that decision and we can get it across the goal line. So with that, I think I'll wrap it up. This is a great conference, Jim, and it was good for me to hear the chief, because he took, there's always, when you follow somebody like that, you're gonna get a little bit of a remarks fratricide, but it's great to be, follow the chief and hear his, so I could follow up and say my own. So with that, I'll end here, and if we have a couple times for questions, we can do that.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I'll follow you, sir.
This way? Okay.
Well, I think we've got 10 minutes, sir, for
okay.
Q&A.
All righty.
So we should have plenty of time. Sam, did you want to attack the first couple?
In terms of questions? Absolutely.
Yes, sir.
Let's start with Stephen Hedger, General, from Rheinmetall. I see him, but we can't hear him.
There we go. I'm unmuted. Maybe that was the McAleese conference saying that we got to quit these Rheinmetall guys poking the Army too much. General Pasquarette, great to see you.
Yep.
Quick comment. I think I saw you last during the AUSA Global Force exchanges.
Right.
You were on a 40 or 45 company, 30-minute slog of a death march.
Yes.
But just really appreciate the commitment you make to engaging us in industry, to keeping us informed of what's going on, and to listening to us as we, excuse the language of bitch and moan sometimes, or educate in other cases. But I appreciate that. I attribute it to you being a fellow dog-faced soldier and Rock of the Marne.
Yep.
To you. What I wanted to ask was, as you've been in all these budget discussions now, and you're getting exposed to the new leadership team at OSD, and we've heard very clearly the Army's commitment to your modernization priorities to 31+4. I'm curious if you can give us some insight into what the toughest questions you're getting from OSD are about the Army program. Where are the friction points? Where are you seeing them push you all a little bit, and you really needing to communicate clearly the priorities?
Well, first I'd say this isn't a rookie team that's come in. They are very experienced in what the nation's asking them to do. Most of them are coming back from previous tours in the building under previous administrations, and so they came in warmed up, and there's not a steep learning curve for them. Incredibly professional. I will say they're not throwing the baby out with the bathwater as they're relooking things. I heard that on the front end, which I think is a good way of looking at it. And the questions they're asking are very good ones, ones that should be asked, frankly. Where's the Army getting pushed? Well, I would tell you that we're having to defend, I think, our end strength. That's the one aspect that we're having to explain. I think the chief articulated it pretty well on why we need, he thinks it probably should be bigger. We're gonna hold where we're at right now, but there is some pressure on our end strength that we're having to make the argument on. To the Army, we think that is, given the pace of activity, that the demand on the Army today, bringing the end strength down only has bad outcomes, we think, for the nation and for our soldiers. And so that is, I think, the one place we're getting pushed, and I know our leadership is very concerned about that. We'll, I think, make that argument with our with OSD as in the months to come.
Well, thanks. I said this to General Murray yesterday, but we in industry, we also think we have a responsibility to help you all communicate and advocate for the Army's needs as well. And at American Rheinmetall, we take that serious, and we look forward to keeping advocating, and we appreciate how much you all are engaging us.
All right, Stephen. Thanks. Good to see you.
Thanks, Stephen. Keith Floyle, Bell Helicopters.
Hey, sir, thank you for sharing your insights today. As you talk about the 31+4 and how things are progressing, do you see any changes in the sequencing of the 31+4 dependent upon the respective progress within the CFTs?
I think the priorities, Keith, are going to remain the same, 1 through 6, if you're talking that. I will tell you, cost. If we have to make tough decisions, cost, schedule, and performance is what's going to rule, and that'll drive decisions on. If we have to make decisions to slow something down, it's what's performing, what's staying at cost, and is on schedule. It'll be hard to kind of take dollars out of that. There's others that, you know, of 35 efforts there, there's probably some that are having a red or yellow light. And that becomes a place that maybe we need to take some dollars if we have to. Now, General Murray, that is really in his wheelhouse. I manage the dollars and where they're parked. And that will be really the Secretary and the Chief's decision as recommended by General Murray. But cost, schedule, and performance is really what will drive that. My own sense, and I was going to say it in my remarks, but I kind of flitted through it there, is we have to get the network right. That's number 4 in the priorities. Because the issue we have with long-range fires today, but if we do not get the network right, the investments in all the other CFT efforts will be sub-optimized. So we have the most dollars, and we have about $14, $15 billion across the FYDP in the network alone.
Thank you, sir.
Sure.
Sydney Freeberg.
Oh, yes. Sydney, how you doing?
Do we have Sydney?
Hi, now I think I'm audible.
There he is.
General, could you give us, you gave the example of the Q-53 as an example of, you know, a critical enabler that's in the sort of second 30. Can you give us a few more examples from that category? Obviously, it's all pre-decisional, but a few more examples of those critical supporting systems. And maybe a few more examples like the M113 of things that are purely in a holding pattern awaiting replacement.
Yeah. So a good example, I think some of our artillery rounds, I think with IRCA, I think that's something we're developing outside of the CFT. Sydney, before I go to bed tonight, I'm going to send you some good examples because I don't have them at my fingertips. But I know there's some of it is ammunition that we have to develop that is not the CFT responsibility, but we have to develop something that can stand the pressure of the gun that that's gonna shoot that we don't have today as an example. But I will send you an email with 3 or 4 more examples. The M113, and I'll come up with more of the, and really, frankly, those two definitions, Sydney, we just got that codified. General Murray just approved those within the last day or two. And I said, okay, now it's time to start and bin our equipment in enduring and legacy bins so we can kind of explain them. Because I think legacy will end up being more of a target than enduring because we have to have the enduring resource to fight alongside the CFTs. So I'll get you a better answer before I go home tonight.
Well, thank you, sir. I appreciate that.
Okay.
Always glad to make you work longer and later.
All right. Good to see you, Sydney.
Al Pisani. Are you on mute? Going once, going twice. Al Pisani.
Can you hear me?
Now we can.
There he is.
There we go.
Excellent. Thank you. Sorry about that.
You almost didn't make the cut there, Al.
Yeah, almost. Under the wire. Sir, given the drawdown in Afghanistan and the imperiled OCO funding that we hear about, and obviously the competing AORs of Indo-PACOM and UCOM, I'm just curious in your calculus, and we hear about over the horizon capabilities in that CENTCOM AOR, how do you balance those? That's a hell of a job and a hell of a proposition to have to deal with in terms of that portfolio requirements. I'm just curious what your thinking is.
Well, I mean, any programmer, and that's, you know, I have the Army's programmer works for me. He's an exceptional officer. It ends up being these three dials we've talked about, and how I describe it, under a steady top line, the three dials are like gears that are connected. And if you under a steady top line, if you say, I want to grow end strength, I'm going to turn that dial up. Well, you got to turn the others down because they're interconnected under a steady top line. If you have a significant drop or a significant increase in top line, the gears pull apart. And you can turn all of them up or down, If you want to increase readiness, you want to increase end strength, and you want to continue to modernize at a higher level, if your end strength's big enough, you can do that. Right. So right now we're looking at possibly a lower top line. Those gears will get pulled apart, and then our decision makers down the hall, we tee up all bad options, and we try and sell them the pros and cons and the risk, and then they have to make the hard calls, and we try and tee it all up for them. And if they want to hold end, if they want to hold end strength towards that, we have a big, and that's where we're at right now because of the importance of all those commitments we have around the world. Well, that drives hard decisions in the other areas of readiness and modernization. How do you cut balance under a lower top line that's significant? And so, it's not easy. We have to make our argument down the hall to OSD on the resources we need to have. We don't know our top line for POM 23 now, the fiscal guidance, but if it comes, and I know General Murray talked about that yesterday, those hard decisions will be made. And as I mentioned, just in the equipping portfolio, we're in a very fragile position.
And if I understand you correctly, of your $180 billion a year, at least $60 billion is tied up in total active duty plus National Guard end strength. And so that's a pretty inflexible block.
Well, 44, 45 cents on the dollar of all of our TOA is manpower.
Yes, sir.
And it's like must pay. You can't say, I'm just not going to pay them as much because I have to bring, over top
line.
Yes,
sir.
So it puts pressure on the other aspects when you have so much tied up in manpower.
Yes, sir.
So, somebody, a senator once asked me, why is the Department of Defense budget so big? Russia and China's together is not combined anywhere near. Well, part of it's we pay our people well, because and you get what you pay for. We have the best of our society. I'm biased maybe on that, but they raised their hand to join the ranks. The other two armies we're worried about, the other two adversaries, they don't pay them anything, and I think you get what you pay for when it comes to people.
Yes, sir.
So,
thank you, sir.
Sure.
Jim, we got a red light. I know
you're
going to close us out.
Not to be inappropriate. So what we could do, we had 10 minutes to work with. Undersecretary Cummings is on at 3:55. So we have time for one or two more questions that are important. And then most importantly, sir, what are the things that in terms of that 65 that are the enabling, right? Those are absolutely sacred. What are the types of things that are down in that other 55 that are on the verge?
Right? Well, you're talking those other 500 programs that are not the 65. The 65 are the CFTs, that's 35, and about another 30, 35 or so that are the key enablers.
Yes, sir.
And again, half of our dollars are against them. Then you have about 500 other programs where the other half of the TOA or dollars are against. And now that I described that, what's your question, Jim?
No, I that's perfect. I just wanted to know what the mixture was.
Okay.
And
yeah.
The chief made a reference to, he made a reference to that 50%, and he said there's some things that we'd have to start buying at slower rates than we would otherwise like to. And I assume that's what he was.
Well, I think he was talking about if we had to make hard calls, if we don't have the top line, and it comes to the equipping portfolio to pay a bill that right now we're not having to if under new top line. There's this hard call I talked about. Do we have to reduce more in a place where they're right on the viability of the program? They're at MSR already, or do we have to go to the CFTs and slow down our CFTs and some of them that aren't performing, or maybe we might rank order them based on what do we need in versus the pacing threat,
right,
and slow them down. Neither are a good option.
Yes, sir.
But it's something we may have to face, and those decisions will be before our leadership to face.
And then a silly question. My recollection is about $48 billion-ish is O&M for both active duty and also Guard and Reserve. There's no place left to find any additional flex in there, I presume.
Well, if Charlie Flynn was sitting here, the G3, I've heard him say that we've taken, as we've been doing what-if drills on things, and it's like, yes, I think all the services are. And as you go down looking at where will we go to pull the lever on OMA and readiness, there's a lot of bad ideas there too. I know General McConville does not want to walk away from readiness. okay?
Yes, sir.
He wants to modernize the Army every, you know, the first time in 40. So, and then he wants to hold on end strength. And with all those three combined, if we have a top line that doesn't support that where we want to be,
yes,
it
sir.
Is going to drive those hard decisions. And there's no good answers in both readiness and modernization right now where to go.
Yes, sir.
General, in that context, just institutionally, how does the Army assess the risk associated with this hard choice as it relates going forward? I mean, there's already the sort of public perception that the great power competition as it relates to China doesn't really play to the Army. It's an Air Force, Navy, Space Force engagement, which hurts you. And then you've got the drawdown issues, and then you have this overall modernization objective. So how do you assess the risk to inform your decisions going forward in that difficult?
Yeah, I mean, I've served in the Pacific for 5 years. I was a 2-star out there for those 5 years, and in USARPAC, I'll start with that part, Rod, U.S. Army Pacific, and then 3 years in Japan. And listen, it is a joint fight out there, and you can't have one arm behind your back by saying one service doesn't have a role out there. The Army has an essential role to any operations in the Indo-Pacific, and as does all the services. Listen, it's if we think it's going to be just some little Taiwan Straits thing, anything that would, in the worst day, happen in that theater relative to our adversary, it's going to be global. And to think we're going to just have this little part of the earth that we're worried about, I think, is short-sighted. And then services, you know, we'll be working together on this, and we all value each other's contributions, and the Army provides a unique one that can make a difference out there. I'll say that up front. So on risk, how do we assess the risk? Well, you know, in the training world and the readiness world, there's all kind of models that look at the number of forces we have to have ready to meet combatant commander requirements. There's these risk assessments that are done. It turns, and over time, you can see if you don't, and the hard part for the Army is hard, and it is harder than the other service. A dollar in for readiness gets what for output? It's easier in the other services because
yes,
readiness in the Army is so much more dynamic when you're talking ground forces.
Yes, sir.
And so that's been a challenge for us, but we have done some modeling on that, and we know the dollars we need to have the forces available to support combatant commanders.
Yes, sir. And then a silly question, sir?
Sure.
Given that we've covered the entire portfolio, should we leave it there?
What's that?
In terms of just the is there any last thoughts, right, in terms of last issues that we need to be focused on?
No, I'm not convinced we're going to have who knows where our top line's going to be, and there's a lot of dynamics at play right now.
Yes, sir.
I'm very confident in the current leadership. They're here for the best, for the best of our nation. They're
yes,
going to
sir.
Make the right decisions for our country. Once,
yes, sir.
And so the Army's going to be, we're going to, whatever the top line is, we're going to have a great Army. And we even if faced with tough decisions, we have the right leadership in place to see that through.
Well spoken, sir.
So
well done.
All right.
I apologize for forcing you to go after the chief. That
no,
was
no,
magnificent
no, no. That's
work.
Okay. Yeah, that was good.